In the previous video, the robot's end effector velocity, v-tip, was the time derivative of a minimum set of coordinates describing the end effector's configuration. The Jacobian J maps the joint velocities to v-tip. For this 2R robot, the Jacobian has two columns, one for each joint, which we call J1 and J2. Each column is the contribution to v-tip when the speed at that joint is 1 and the speed at all other joints is 0. In this video, the end effector velocity will be represented by the twist, Vs, represented in the space frame, S. We call the corresponding Jacobian the space Jacobian, Js. It also has two columns, one for each joint. Since Vs is a 6 vector and there are two joints, the space Jacobian is a 6x2 matrix. For a general open chain robot with n joints, the space Jacobian is 6xn. Each column of the space Jacobian is the spatial twist when that joint's velocity is 1 and the velocity at all other joints is 0. To derive the form of the space Jacobian, let's use a specific example, a 5R arm whose joint angles are given by theta 1 through theta 5. Then the space Jacobian is 6x5. Let's focus on JS3, the third column of the space Jacobian, which corresponds to the spatial twist when the velocity at joint 3 is 1 and the velocity at all other joints is 0. If all joint angles are 0, then JS3 is simply S3, the screw axis of joint 3 when the arm is at its 0 configuration. We use this in Chapter 4 for the product of exponentials formula in the S frame. To find the column of the space Jacobian, though, we need the spatial twist corresponding to a unit velocity at joint 3 when the robot is at an arbitrary configuration, not just the 0 configuration. So let's start moving the joints of the robot and see how that affects JS3. First, we rotate joint 5. Because joint 5 is not between joint 3 and the S frame, the relationship between joint 3 and the S frame is not affected by joint 5's angle. Therefore, JS3 is unaffected by joint 5's value, and JS3 is still equal to S3 at this configuration of the robot. Now we rotate joint 4. Again, JS3 is unaffected by joint 4's value. Now we rotate joint 3. Again, the configuration of joint 3 relative to the S frame is unaffected by this motion, so JS3 is unaffected by joint 3's value. Now we rotate joint 2 by theta 2. Now we see that the configuration of joint 3 has moved relative to the S frame, so JS3 must change. But we've drawn a new frame, S prime, that has the same relationship to joint 3 that the frame S had to joint 3 before joint 2 moved. Therefore, the twist due to a unit velocity at joint 3 in the S prime frame is just S3, the spatial screw axis when the robot was at its 0 configuration. The configuration of S prime in the S frame can be written e to the bracket S2 theta 2, the displacement achieved by the S frame by following the screw axis of joint 2 by an angle theta 2. Now we rotate joint 1 by theta 1. Again, joint 3 moves relative to the S frame, so JS3 changes. We draw a new frame, S double prime, where the relationship between joint 3 and S double prime is the same as the relationship between joint 3 and S when the robot is at its 0 configuration. The frame S double prime is obtained from the frame S prime by rotating it about the joint 1 axis by an angle theta 1. Because the joint 1 axis is represented by the spatial screw axis S1, performing the transformation in the space frame corresponds to multiplying TSS prime by e to the bracket S1 theta 1 on the left, yielding this expression for the S double prime frame in the S frame. The reason we constructed this S double prime frame is that the screw axis of the third joint is the same in the S double prime frame as the screw axis S3 of the third joint in the S frame when the arm is at its 0 configuration. So, to find JS3, we just need to express S3, now corresponding to the screw axis in the S double prime frame, to the screw axis expressed in the S frame. We use our standard rule for changing the reference frame of a twist, which gives us this final expression. The same reasoning applies for any joint, not just joint 3 of this 5R robot. Joint positions of joints between the joint and the S frame must be taken into account, while joint positions that do not affect the relationship between the joint and the S frame can be ignored. We can generalize to this definition of the space Jacobian JS. The first column of the space Jacobian is just the screw axis S1 when the robot is at its 0 configuration. It does not depend on the joint positions because no joint is between joint 1 and the S frame. Any other column I of the space Jacobian is given by the screw axis SI pre-multiplied by the transformation that expresses the screw axis in the S frame for arbitrary joint positions. You can see that JS2 depends only on the position of joint 1, JS3 depends only on the positions of joints 1 and 2, etc. Notice that no differentiation is necessary to calculate the Jacobian. Also, the space Jacobian is independent of the choice of the end effector B frame. In the next video, we will do a similar derivation for the body Jacobian, where the end effector twist is expressed in the end effector frame B.